Hi, well, yes, David Malin, who's going to be speaking to you next, and I were both members of the class of 99, and we each had the same terrified moment this morning when we realized that it was 20 years ago exactly we were sitting in your chairs. And this is terrifying, I think, for all of us, for the two of us, because you all weren't born at that moment. So it follows that we are officially old. Terrifying for you, because apparently you're all in grave danger of becoming Harvard faculty members. So I'm going to talk very briefly about a question and a suggestion about how we might go about answering it. The question is a pretty straightforward one. What exactly is the form of government under which we live in the United States? And my suggestion is that we could get a different perspective on that question that might be valuable if we're prepared to take seriously a rather unaccustomed understanding of the American Revolution. And in order to try to give you a sense of what that understanding looks like, I want to begin with a single moment that takes place in the Constitutional Convention on June 1st, 1787. It's the first moment at which the presidency is debated in the convention. And the discussion is introduced by James Wilson of Pennsylvania, one of the most important figures in the convention, actually, by, for my money, the father of the Constitution. Wilson makes the motion that will create the presidency. He moves that the executive power, as he puts it, shall consist in a single person. Madison, in his notes on the convention, reports that at this moment there was a pause as people tried to digest Wilson's proposal, and then immediately a rather fierce debate. One of Wilson's fellow delegates, Edmund Randolph of Virginia, gets up and objects immediately. Wilson's proposal, he said, would create a fetus of monarchy. That is, an institution that would ineluctably grow into full-blown monarchy and was therefore dangerous, but also unacceptable, he said, because it flew in the face of revolution principles. The revolution, according to Randolph, was a revolution against the British crown. We'd fought a whole revolutionary war to get rid of the thing, and now, having finally gotten clear of them, we're prepared to turn around and adopt something very much like the British model if we follow Wilson's proposal for a new chief executive given sweeping prerogative powers. So how can that be right? And he sits down. Wilson then gets up and responds, and he has a number of points to offer. But the primary one is a response to Randolph's understanding of what the revolution was about. And this is what Wilson says. The people of America did not oppose the British king, but the Parliament. The opposition was not against a unity, but a corrupt multitude. So on Wilson's account, which he goes on to flesh out in great detail, it's just a mistake to think that the revolution was anti-monarchical. Quite the contrary. The revolution, rightly understood, was a rebellion in favor of royal power. The patriots were proposing to augment and strengthen the prerogatives of the crown so that it could defend them against the tyrannical behavior of a foreign legislature, namely the British Parliament. So for Wilson, it follows that if you're interested in continuing and abiding by and then applying revolutionary principles, you should want exactly the sort of chief executive that he was proposing, because that, after all, had been what the revolution was about. So this is Wilson's account, and the question is it true? I think the answer is quite substantially true. And in order to see why, we have to get ourselves back into the specific predicament in which British Americans found themselves in the early 1760s and 1770s. This is in the wake of the great British victory in the French and Indian War, what everywhere else in the universe calls the Seven Years' War. And having won the war, Britain now had bills to pay. And Parliament set about raising money, first of all, by enforcing in a sort of newly vigorous way a set of existing duties on trade, but also famously by levying a direct tax in America through the Stamp Act. British Americans opposed these measures, but they couldn't quite figure out initially what it was precisely they objected to. They began trying to argue that Parliament had some jurisdiction over America, but not the relevant kind. And they're sort of fits and starts as they're engaged in this fierce pamphlet debate, one of the major participants in which is James Otis, who's standing right there. At the end, they realize that what they actually have to say in the debate is something rather different. And so their final position, which is adopted by every colonial legislature and eventually by the Continental Congress itself, is that actually Parliament has no jurisdiction whatsoever over British America. Well, how can you think that? Because they also wanted to say we're subjects of the British Empire. So how can you be subjects of the British Empire who are exempt from the jurisdiction of the Supreme Legislature of the British Empire? The answer to the question was to say we're simply connected through the person of the king. The king just happens to be king of several distinct dominions. He's king of Great Britain and governs it in accordance in conjunction with the British Parliament, but he's also Prince Elector of Hanover, because remember these are Germans. He's also king of Virginia, he's king of Massachusetts, he's king of New York, and so on. And it is the king himself, separate from his British ministers, who must stand at the center of this union, wielding his prerogatives to impose harmony. This was a vision of monarchy and empire that was unthinkable in Britain itself. In the late 18th century, because the British had fought two revolutions in the 17th century to abolish the independent prerogatives of the crown and to subject their kings to Parliament. The crown still had legal powers that were quite sweeping, but these were wielded in almost all cases not by the king himself, but rather by his ministers who had to maintain the support of a parliamentary majority. What the Americans were proposing, as was immediately clear to their opponents in Britain, was a massive strengthening of the crown, a sort of turning back the clock to the 17th century British monarchy, when the British monarch still had a veto and other sweeping prerogatives, in order to create a new kind of king-emperor. And patriots were very overt about the fact that this is what they wanted. Here is Benjamin Franklin, for example, one of the most enthusiastic royalists of this stripe in the 1760s. It is the problem, he says, that the Lords in Commons seem to have been long encroaching on the rights of their and our sovereign, assuming too much of his authority and betraying his interests. Whereas here is Alexander Hamilton writing when he was still an undergraduate in King's College. The great danger in the English Constitution, particularly as it relates to empire, Hamilton announced, is that his contemporaries risk losing sight of that share which the king has in the sovereignty, both of Great Britain and America. That's the problem. And this constitutional analysis of what had gone wrong, that is, that the imperial constitution and American liberty had been endangered by the erosion of crown power, not by its increase, is picked up and deployed in a remarkable range of sources, both public and private. I'll just read you one. This is Benjamin Rush, one of the most important leaders of the founding generation, a Pennsylvania patriot, also a physician. And in 1768, he found himself in London as a tourist. He was in Britain, in Scotland, for medical school, but he'd gone to London as a tourist, and he visits the Houses of Parliament, as one could still do today as a tourist, and he takes the tour. So first he goes into the House of Lords. His guide takes him in, and there he sees the throne. And this is what he writes back in a letter to a dear friend. He says, "I felt as if I walked on sacred ground. I gazed for some time at the throne with emotions I cannot describe. I asked our guide if it was common for strangers to sit down upon it. He told me no. But upon my importuning him a good deal, I prevailed upon him to allow me the liberty. I accordingly advanced toward it and sat in it for a considerable time. When I first got into it, I was seized with a sense of horror, which for some time interrupted my ordinary train of thinking. This, said I, is the golden period of the worldly man's wishes. His passions conceive, his hopes aspire to nothing beyond this throne." So this is the transcendent experience he has in the House of Lords. He has a very different experience when he moves on to the House of Commons, and this is what he writes. "From this I went on to the House of Commons. I cannot say as if I felt I walked on sacred ground here. This, thought I, is where the infernal scheme for enslaving America was first broached. Here the usurping commons first endeavored to rob the king of his supremacy over the colonies and divide it among themselves. O cursed haunt of venality, bribery, and corruption." And what he's referring to, this terrible moment of original sin when the House of Commons first tries to rob the king of his supremacy over America, is in 1651, when the Parliament had beheaded their sovereign, Charles I, and in his absence had taken the opportunity to pass the first bill legislating for America, the Navigation Act, which remained in place until the Revolution. And so this was the great error. It was only when they'd murdered their king that Parliament had managed to get their hands on the colonies, and this was the great mistake in constitutionalism that had not been remedied. And this view of what the conflict was about persisted for a remarkably long time, even through the beginning of open war. So about 200 yards from where we're sitting, on May 1st of 1775, the Continental Army is mustered on Cambridge Common, and a British officer witnesses the scene and reports on developments to his superior in a dispatch, and this is what he writes. "The rebels have erected the standard at Cambridge," that is the royal standard. "They call themselves the king's troops and us the Parliament's." Pretty burlesque. And this is true all over America. The Continentals are the king's troops and the redcoats are the Parliament troops. Well, George III had no interest in taking up this invitation offered by his American subjects to become this new kind of king emperor. As he wrote over and over again, he would fight the battle of the legislature. That is, he would insist on the rights of Parliament and resist this move to assign him new prerogatives that none of his predecessors for 100 years had actually enjoyed, not least because he knew what happened to the last monarchs who tried to do that. And so he removes American subjects from his protection, declares them in rebellion, and the revolution comes. The remarkable thing is that even after kingship in America is abolished and America moves toward independence, these figures who defend this very prerogativist 17th century understanding of monarchy and its proper role in a constitution, the sorts of prerogative powers that a monarch should have, in essence never change their minds. And they go on to become the major advocates for executive power through the 1770s into the 1780s, and eventually the architects of the presidency. And this was a point that they made early and often. Not only Wilson, but here is Abigail Adams writing about her husband John to her son John Quincy. This is just before the Constitutional Convention in 1787. She writes a letter saying that before this reaches you, Mr. Adams's book will have arrived, and that is his defense of the constitutions of government of the United States, which was massively influential in the Constitutional Convention. "I should like to know its reception," she says. "I tell him they will think in America that he is for setting up a king. He says no, but he is for giving to the governors of each state the same authority which the British king has under the true British constitution, balancing his power by the two other branches." That is, the powers that the king had under the proper form of the British Constitution, not the late 18th century parliamentary monarch, but the 17th century independent prerogativist monarch armed with his veto and other powers. And Adams viewed the results in Philadelphia with great satisfaction for this reason. In 1789, he observes to a fellow delegate, Roger Sherman, "Let us now consider what our Constitution is, and see whether any other name can with propriety be given it than that of a monarchical republic, or if you will, a limited monarchy." Now, the point is captured in a really interesting way by these two famous portraits. On the one hand, the ceremonial of kingship, the majesty, the reverence, the bowing, was, for the most part, no longer really thinkable in American political culture after the Revolution. The rupture with Britain had done far too much work for that, although not all of the work. You'll notice here that these two portraits, Gilbert Stuart's famous portrait of Washington, Alan Ramsay's coronation portrait of George III, the most obvious thing is the difference. George in his royal robes, Washington in his simple black velvet suit. But the similarities in the iconography are also pretty striking when you get to look at them. Look at the curtain. Exactly the same color, the column, the table, the carpet, and so on. This is a monarchical figure, just a different kind of monarchical figure. And it's a point that was made by American authors very energetically, and this is where I will leave you. This is Washington Irving writing in 1819 in Rip Van Winkle. And the story is probably known to you. Rip goes to sleep before the Revolution and wakes up years later after it, and walks back into his town where he is very disoriented. When he reaches the old village inn, in particular, he famously receives quite a shock. And this is how Irving describes the scene. Instead of the great tree that used to shelter the quiet little Dutch inn of yore, there now was reared a tall naked pole with something on the top that looked like a red nightcap. And from it was fluttering a flag on which was a singular assemblage of stars and stripes. All this was strange and incomprehensible. He recognized on the sign, however, the ruby face of King George, under which he had smoked so many a peaceful pipe. But even this was singularly metamorphosed. The red coat was changed for one of blue and buff. A sword was held in the hand instead of a scepter. The head was decorated with a cocked hat, and underneath was painted in large characters, General Washington. So Rip finds that while Washington has quite literally taken the king's place, as in this portrait, he has not inherited the accoutrement of royalty. He does not carry a scepter. His coat is Republican blue, not regal red. He is emphatically General Washington, not King George. But Rip recognizes that this new creature is at once less and more than a king. George III's replacement may lack regal splendor, but he carries a sword. While the king reigns, this man seems to rule. The imperial crisis of the late 18th century, I want to suggest to you, set in motion a profoundly ironic divergence between British and American political cultures. Great Britain, with its kings and queens, would consolidate the Whig constitution against which patriots had rebelled, eventually placing supreme, unchecked political power in a single legislative chamber elected by the people. The new American Republic, in contrast, would evolve and perfect a recognizably royalist constitution, investing its chief magistrate with the very same prerogative powers that patriots had unsuccessfully attempted to persuade George III to revive during the imperial crisis of the 1760s and 1770s. On one side of the Atlantic, there would be kings without monarchy. On the other, monarchy without kings. Which of the two sides got the better of the bargain is, of course, an open question, but at least it's the right one. Thanks.